Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Cruel and Unusual by Patricia D. Cornwell, narrated by C.J. Critt. This work is copyrighted 1993 by Patricia D. Cornwell. This recording is copyrighted 1993 by Recorded Books. Kay Scarpetta is preparing for an autopsy, part of her everyday duties as Virginia's chief medical examiner. This time around, it's somehow disquieting, for her subject at the moment is very much alive. A convicted murderer, Ronnie Joe Waddell, a 9-year resident on death row, waits for a last-minute pardon from the governor. Without it, today he faces the electric chair. And now, Cruel and Unusual.
Prologue. A meditation at Spring Street by the Damned. It's 2 weeks before Christmas. 4 days before nothing at all. I lie on my iron bed staring at my dirty bare feet and the white toilet missing its seat. And when cockroaches crawl across the floor, I don't jump anymore. I watch them the same way they watch me. I close my eyes and breathe slow. I remember raking hay in the heat of day and getting no pay compared to the way white folk live. I dream of roasting peanuts in a tin, and when the tomatoes are in, eating them like apples. I imagine driving the pickup truck, sweat shining on my face in that no future place I swore I'd leave. I can't use the john, blow my nose, or smoke without guards taking notes. There's no clock. I never know the weather. I open my eyes and see a blank wall going on forever. What's a man supposed to feel when he's about to be gone? Like a sad, sad song, I don't know the words. I can't remember. They say it happened in September when the sky was like a robin's egg and leaves were on fire and falling to the ground. They say a beast got loose in the city. Now there's one less sound. Killing me won't kill the beast. The dark is his friend, flesh and blood his feast. When you think it's safe to stop looking, that's when you'd better start looking, brother. One sin leads to another. Ronnie Joe Waddell. Chapter 1. The Monday I carried Ronnie Joe Waddell's meditation in my pocketbook, I never saw the sun. It was dark out when I drove to work that morning. It was dark again when I drove home. Small raindrops spun in my headlights, the night gloomy with fog and bitterly cold. I built a fire in my living room and envisioned Virginia farmland and tomatoes ripening in the sun. I imagined a young black man in the hot cab of a pickup truck and wondered if his head had been full of murder back then. Waddell's meditation had been published in the Richmond Times-Dispatch, and I had taken the clipping to work to add to his growing file. But the business of the day distracted me, and his meditation had remained in my pocketbook. I had read it several times. I supposed it would always intrigue me that poetry and cruelty could reside in the same heart. For the next few hours I paid bills and wrote Christmas cards while the television played mutely. Like the rest of Virginia's citizens, whenever an execution was scheduled, I found out from the media whether all appeals had been exhausted or the governor had granted clemency. The news determined whether I went on to bed or drove downtown to the morgue. At almost 10 p.m., my telephone rang. I answered it, expecting my deputy chief or some other member of my staff whose evening, like mine, was on hold. "Hello?" asked a male voice I didn't recognize. "I'm trying to reach Kay Scarpetta." The chief medical examiner, Dr. Scarpetta? "Speaking," I said.
"Oh, good. Detective Joe Trent with Henrico County. Found your number in the book.
Sorry to bother you at home. He sounded keyed up. But we've got a situation we really need your help with. What's the problem? I asked, staring tensely at the TV. A commercial was playing. I hoped I wasn't needed at a scene. Earlier this evening, a 13-year-old white male was abducted after leaving a convenience store on Northside. He was shot in the head, and there may be some sexual components involved. My heart sank as I reached for paper and pen. Where is the body? I asked. He was found behind a grocery store in Patterson Avenue in the county. I mean, he's not dead. He hasn't regained consciousness, but no one's saying right now whether he'll make it. I realize it's not your case since he's not dead, but he's got some injuries that are real odd. They're not like anything I've ever come across. I know you see a lot of different type of injuries. I'm hoping you might have some idea how these were inflicted and why. Describe them for me, I said. We're talking about two areas. One on his inner right thigh, you know, up high near the groin. The other's in the area of his right shoulder. Chunks of flesh are missing, cut out. And there's weird cuts and scratches around the edges of the wounds. He's at Henrico Doctor's. Did you find the excised tissue? My mind was racing through other cases, looking for something similar. Not so far. We've got men out there still searching. But it's possible the assault occurred inside a car. Whose car? The assailant's. The grocery store parking lot where the kid was found is a good 3 or 4 miles from the convenience store where he was last seen. I'm thinking he got into somebody's car. Maybe was forced to. You got photographs of the injuries before the doctors started working on him? Yes, but they haven't done much. Because of the amount of skin missing, they'll have to do skin grafts. Full grafts, is what they said, if that tells you anything. It told me they had debrided the wounds, had him on intravenous antibiotics, and were waiting to do a gluteal graft. If, however, that was not the case, and they had undermined the tissue around the injuries and sutured them, then there wasn't going to be much left for me to see. They haven't sutured his wounds, I said. That's what I've been told. Do you want me to take a look? That would be really great, he said, relieved. You should be able to see the wounds real well. When would you like me to do this? Tomorrow would work. All right. What time? The earlier the better. 800 hours? I'll meet you in front of the ER. I'll be there, I said as the anchorman stared grimly at me. Hanging up, I reached for the remote control and turned up the sound. Eugenia, can you tell us if there's been any word from the governor? The camera shifted to the Virginia State Penitentiary, where for 200 years the Commonwealth's worst criminals had been warehoused along a rocky stretch of the James River at the edge of downtown. Sign-carrying protesters and capital punishment enthusiasts gathered in the dark, their faces harsh in the glare of television lights. It chilled my soul that some people were laughing. A pretty young correspondent in a red coat filled the screen. As you know, Bill, she said, yesterday a telephone line was set up between Governor Noring's office and the penitentiary. Still no word, and that speaks volumes. Historically, when the governor doesn't intend to intervene, he remains silent. How are things there? Is it relatively peaceful so far? So far, yes, Bill. I'd say several hundred people are standing vigil out here, and of course the penitentiary itself is almost empty. All but several dozen of the inmates have already been transported to the new correctional facility in Greensville. I turned off the TV, and moments later was driving east with my doors locked and the radio on. Fatigue seeped through me like anesthesia. I felt dreary and numb. I dreaded executions. I dreaded waiting for someone to die, then running my scalpel through flesh as warm as mine. I was a physician with a law degree. I had been trained to know what gave life and what took it, what was right and what was wrong. Then experience had become my mentor, wiping its feet on that pristine part of myself that was idealistic and analytical. It's disheartening when a thinking person is forced to admit that many clichés are true. There is no justice on this earth. Nothing would ever undo what Ronnie Joe Waddell had done. He'd been on death row 9 years. His victim hadn't been my case, because she had been murdered before I had been appointed chief medical examiner of Virginia and had moved to Richmond. But I had reviewed her records. I was well aware of every savage detail. On the morning of September 4th, 10 years before, Robin Naismith called in sick at Channel 8, where she was an anchorwoman. She went out to buy cold remedies and returned home. The next day, her nude, battered body was found in her living room, propped against the TV. A bloody thumbprint recovered from the medicine cabinet was later identified as Ronnie Joe Waddell's. There were a number of cars parked behind the morgue when I pulled in. My deputy chief, Fielding, was already there. So was my administrator, Ben Stevens, and morgue supervisor, Susan Story. The bay door was open, lights inside dimly illuminating the tarmac beyond, and a Capitol Police officer was sitting in his marked car, smoking. He got out as I parked. "Safe to keep the bay door open?" I asked. He was a tall, gaunt man with thick white hair. Though I had talked to him many times in the past, I couldn't remember his name. "Appears okay at the moment, Dr. Scarpetta," he said, zipping up his heavy nylon jacket. "I haven't seen any troublemakers around. But as soon as corrections gets here, I'll close it and make sure it stays closed." "Fine, as long as you'll be right here in the meantime." "Yes, ma'am, you can count on that. And we'll have a couple more uniformed men back here in case there's a problem. Apparently, there's a lot of protesters. I guess you read in the paper about that petition all those people signed and took to the governor. And I heard earlier today some bleeding hearts as far away as California are on a hunger strike." I glanced around the empty parking lot and across Main Street. A car rushed past, tires swishing over wet pavement. Streetlights were smudges in the fog. "Hell, not me. I wouldn't even miss a coffee break for Waddell." The officer cupped his hand around his lighter and began puffing on a cigarette. "After what he'd done to that Naismith girl. You know, I remember watching her on TV. Now, I like my women the same way I like my coffee, sweet and white. But I have to admit, she was the prettiest black girl I ever seen." I had quit smoking barely 2 months ago, and it still made me crazy to watch someone else doing it. "Lord, that must have been close to 10 years ago," he went on. "I'll never forget the uproar, though. One of the worst cases we've ever had around here. You'd thought a grizzly bear got hold of..." I interrupted him. "You'll let us know what's going on?" "Yes, ma'am. They'll radio me and I'll give you the word." He headed back to the shelter of his car. Inside the morgue, fluorescent light bleached the corridor of color. The smell of deodorizer cloying. I passed the small office where funeral homes signed in bodies, then the X-ray room and the refrigerator, which was really a large refrigerated room with double-decker gurneys and two massive steel doors. The autopsy suite was lit up, stainless steel tables polished bright. Susan was sharpening a long knife and Fielding was labeling blood tubes. Both of them looked as tired and unenthusiastic as I felt. "Ben's upstairs in the library watching TV," Fielding said to me. "He'll let us know if there are any new developments." "What's the chance this guy had AIDS?" Susan referred to Waddell as if he already were dead. "I don't know," I said. "We'll double glove, take the usual precautions." "I hope they'll say something if he had it," she persisted. "You know, I don't trust it when they send these prisoners in. I don't think they care if they're HIV positive, because it's not their problem. They're not the ones doing the posts and worrying about needle sticks." Susan had become increasingly paranoid about such occupational hazards as exposure to radiation, chemicals, and diseases. I couldn't blame her. She was several months pregnant, though it barely showed. Slipping on a plastic apron, I went back into the locker room and put on greens, covered my shoes with booties, and got 2 packets of gloves. I inspected the surgical cart parked beside table 3. Everything was labeled with Waddell's name, the date, and an autopsy number. The labeled tubes and cartons would go in the trash if Governor Noring interceded at the last minute. Ronnie Waddell would be deleted from the morgue log. His autopsy number assigned to whoever came in next. At 11 p.m., Ben Stevens came downstairs and shook his head. All of us looked up at the clock. No one spoke. Minutes ticked by. The Capitol police officer walked in, portable radio in hand. I finally remembered his name was Rankin. "He was pronounced at 11:05," he said. "We'll be here in about 15 minutes." The ambulance beeped a warning as it backed into the bay, and when its rear doors swung open, enough Department of Corrections guards hopped out to control a small prison riot. 4 of them slid out the stretcher bearing Ronnie Waddell's body. They carried it up the ramp and inside the morgue, metal clacking, feet scuffing, all of us getting out of the way. Lowering the stretcher to the tile floor without bothering to unfold the legs, they propelled it along like a sled on wheels, its passengers strapped in and covered with a blood-stained sheet. "A nosebleed," one of the guards offered before I could ask the question. "Who had a nosebleed?" I inquired, noting that the guard's gloved hands were bloody. "Mr. Waddell did." "In the ambulance?" I puzzled, for Waddell should not have had a blood pressure by the time he was loaded inside the ambulance. But the guard was preoccupied with other matters, and I didn't get an answer. It would have to wait. We transferred the body to the gurney positioned on top of the floor scale. Busy hands fumbled with unfastening straps and opening the sheet. The door to the autopsy suite quietly shut as the Department of Corrections guards left, just as abruptly as they had appeared. Waddell had been dead exactly 22 minutes. I could smell his sweat, his dirty bare feet, and the faint odor of singed flesh. His right pant leg was pushed up above his knee, his calf dressed in fresh gauze applied post-mortem to his burns. He was a big, powerful man. The newspapers had called him the gentle giant, poetic Ronnie with soulful eyes. Yet there had been a time when he had used the large hands, the massive shoulders and arms before me, to rip the life from another human being. I pulled apart the Velcro fasteners of his light blue denim shirt, checking pockets as I undressed him. Searching for personal effects is pro forma and usually fruitless. Inmates are not supposed to carry anything with them to the electric chair. And I was very surprised when I discovered what appeared to be a letter in the back pocket of his jeans. The envelope hadn't been opened. Written in bold block letters across the front of it was, "Extremely confidential. Please bury with me." "Make a copy of the envelope and whatever's inside, and submit the originals with his personal effects," I said, handing the envelope to Fielding. He tucked it under the autopsy protocol on a clipboard, mumbling, "Jesus, he's bigger than I am." "Amazing that anyone could be bigger than you are," Susan said to my bodybuilder deputy chief.
"Good thing he's not been dead long," he added. "Otherwise, we'd need the jaws of life."
When muscle-bound people have been dead for hours, they are as uncooperative as marble statues. Rigor had not begun to set in. Waddell was limber, as in life. He could have been asleep. It required all of us to transfer him face down to the autopsy table. He weighed 259 pounds. His feet protruded over the table's edge. I was measuring the burns to his leg when the buzzer sounded from the bay. Susan went to see who it was, and shortly Lieutenant Pete Marino walked in, trench coat unbuttoned, one end of the belt trailing along the tile floor. The burn to the back of his calf is 4 by 1 and 1/4 by 2 3/8, I dictated to Fielding. It's dry, contracted, and blistered. Marino lit a cigarette.
"They're raising a stink about him bleeding," he said, and he seemed agitated.
"His rectal temp is 104, Susan said as she removed the chemical thermometer. "That's at 1149.
"You know why his face was bleeding?" Marino asked.
"One of the guards said a nosebleed," I replied, adding, "We need to turn him over." "You saw this on the inner aspect of his left arm?" Susan directed my attention to an abrasion. I examined it through a lens under a strong light. "I don't know. Possibly from one of the restraints. There's one on his right arm, too." I took a look while Marino watched me and smoked. We turned the body, shoving a block under the shoulders. Blood trickled out of the right side of his nose. His head and chin had been shaved to an uneven stubble. I made the Y incision.
"There might be some abrasions here," Susan said, looking at the tongue.
"Take it out." I inserted the thermometer into the liver.
"Jesus," Marino said under his breath.
"Now?" Susan's scalpel was poised. "No, photograph the burns around his head. We need to measure those, then remove the tongue."
"Shit," she complained. "Who used the camera last?"
"Sorry," Fielding said. "There was no film in the drawer. I forgot. By the way, it's your job to keep film in the drawer."
"It would help if you tell me when the film drawer's empty."
"Women are supposed to be intuitive. I didn't think I needed to tell you."
"I got the measurement of these burns around his head," Susan reported, ignoring his remark.
"Okay." Susan gave him the measurements, then started work on the tongue. Marino backed away from the table.
"Jesus," he said again. "That always gets me."
"Liver temp's 105, I reported to Fielding. I glanced up at the clock. Waddell had been dead for an hour. He hadn't cooled much. He was big. Electrocution heats you up. The brain temperatures of smaller men I had autopsied were as high as 110. Waddell's right calf was at least that, hot to the touch, the muscle in total tetanus.
"A little abrasion at the margin, but nothing big time," Susan pointed out to me.
"He bite his tongue hard enough to bleed that much?" Marino asked.
"No," I said.
"Well, they're already raising a stink about it." His voice rose. "I thought you'd want to know."
I paused, resting the scalpel on the edge of the table as it suddenly occurred to me.
"You were a witness."
"Yeah, I told you I was going to be."
Everybody looked at him.
"Trouble's brewing out there," he said. "I don't want no one leaving this joint alone."
"What sort of trouble?" Susan asked.
"A bunch of religious nuts have been hanging out at Spring Street since this morning. Somehow, they got word about his bleeding, and when the ambulance drove off with his body, they started marching in this direction like a bunch of zombies."
"Did you see it when he started bleeding?" Fielding asked him.
"Oh, yeah. They juiced him twice. The first time he made this loud hiss, like steam coming out of a radiator, and the blood started pouring out from under his mask. They're saying the chair might have malfunctioned."
Susan started the striker saw, and no one competed with its loud buzzing as she cut through the skull. I continued examining the organs. Heart was good. Coronaries terrific. When the saw stopped, I resumed dictating to Fielding.
"You got the weight?" he asked.
"Heart weighs 540, and he's got a single adhesion of the left upper lobe to the aortic arch. Even found 4 parathyroids, in case you didn't already get that."
"I got it."
I placed the stomach on the cutting board.
"It's almost tubular."
"You sure?"
Fielding moved closer to inspect.
"That's bizarre. A guy this big needs a minimum of 4,000 calories a day." He wasn't getting it, not lately, I said.
He doesn't have any gastric contents. His stomach is absolutely empty and clean.
He didn't eat his last meal? Marino asked me.
It doesn't appear that he did.
Do they usually?
Yes, I said. Usually. We were finished by 1 a.m. and followed the funeral home attendants out to the bay, where the hearse was waiting. As we walked out of the building, darkness throbbed with red and blue lights. Radio static drifted on the cold, damp air. Engines rumbled, and beyond the chain-link fence enclosing the parking lot was a ring of fire. Men, women, and children stood silently, faces wavering in candlelight. The attendants wasted no time sliding Waddell's body into the back of the hearse and slamming the tailgate shut. Somebody said something I didn't get, and suddenly candles showered over the fence like a storm of falling stars and landed softly on the pavement.
"Goddamn squirrels!" Marino exclaimed.
Wicks glowed orange and tiny flames dotted the tarmac. The hearse hastily began to back out of the bay. Flash guns were going off. I spotted the Channel 8 news van parked on Main Street. Someone was running along the sidewalk. Uniformed men were stamping out the candles, moving toward the fence, demanding that everyone clear the area.
"We don't want any problems here," an officer said. "Not unless some of you want to spend the night in lockup."
"Butchers!" a woman screamed. Other voices joined in, and hands grabbed the chain-link fence, shaking it. Marino hurried me to my car. A chant rose with tribal intensity. "Butchers! Butchers! Butchers!" I fumbled with my keys, dropped them on the floor mat, snatched them up, and managed to find the right one.
"I'm following you home," Marino said.
I turned the heater on high, but couldn't get warm. Twice I checked to make sure my doors were locked. The night took on a surreal quality, a strange asymmetry of light and dark windows, and shadows moved in the corners of my eyes. We drank scotch in my kitchen because I was out of bourbon.
"I don't know how you stand this stuff," Marino said rudely.
"Help yourself to whatever else there is in the bar," I told him.
"I'll tough it out."
I wasn't quite sure how to broach the subject, and it was obvious that Marino wasn't going to make it easy for me. He was tense, his face flushed. Strands of gray hair clung to his moist, balding head, and he was chain-smoking. "Have you ever witnessed an execution before?" I asked.
"Never had a strong urge to."
"But you volunteered this time, so the urge must have been pretty strong."
"I bet if you put some lemon and soda water in this, it wouldn't be half bad."
"If you want me to ruin good scotch, I'll be glad to see what I can do." He slid the glass toward me, and I went to the refrigerator.
"I've got bottled key lime juice, but no lemon."
I searched shelves.
"That's fine."
I dribbled key lime juice into his glass, then added the Schweppes. Oblivious to the strange concoction he was sipping, he said,
"Maybe you've forgotten, but the Robin Naismith case was mine. Mine and Sonny Jones."
"I wasn't around then."
"Oh, yeah. Funny, it seems like you've been here forever. But you know what happened, right?"
"I was the deputy chief medical examiner for Dade County when Robin Naismith was murdered, and I remembered reading about the case, following it in the news, and later seeing a slide presentation about it at a national meeting. The former Miss Virginia was a stunning beauty with a gorgeous alto voice. She was articulate and charismatic before the camera. She was only 27 years old. The defense claimed that Ronnie Waddell's intent was burglary, and Robin's misfortune was to walk in on it after returning home from the drugstore. Allegedly, Waddell did not watch television and was unfamiliar with her name or brilliant future when he was ransacking her residence and brutalizing her. He was so hopped up on drugs, the defense argued, that he didn't know what he was doing. The jurors rejected Waddell's temporary insanity plea and recommended the death penalty.
I know the pressure to catch her killer was incredible, I said to Marino. Friggin' unbelievable. We had this great latent print. We had bite marks. We had three guys doing a cold search through the files morning, noon, and night. I got no idea how many hours I put in on that damn case. Then we catch the bastard because he's driving around North Carolina with an expired inspection sticker.
He paused, his eyes hard when he added,
"Of course, Jones wasn't around by then. Too damn bad he missed out on seeing Waddell get his reward."
"Do you blame Waddell for what happened to Sonny Jones?" I asked.
"Hey, what do you think?"
"He was a close friend."
"We worked homicide together, fished together, was on the same bowling team."
"I know his death was hard for you."
"Yeah, well, the case wore him down. Working all hours, no sleep, never home. And that sure as hell didn't help matters with his wife. He kept telling me he couldn't take it no more. And then he stopped telling me anything. One night he decides to eat his gun."
"I'm sorry," I said gently. "But I'm not sure you can blame Waddell for that."
"I had a score to settle."
"And was it settled when you witnessed his execution?" At first, Marino did not reply. He stared across the kitchen, his jaw rigidly set. I watched him smoke and drain his drink. "Can I refresh that?"
"Yo, why not?"
I got up and did my thing again as I thought about the injustices and losses that had gone into the making of Marino. He had survived a loveless, impoverished childhood in the wrong part of New Jersey and nursed an abiding distrust of anyone whose lot had been better. Not long ago, his wife of 30 years had left him, and he had a son nobody seemed to know anything about. Regardless of his loyalty to law and order and his record of excellent police work, it was not in his genetic code to get along with the brass. It seemed his life's journey had placed him on a hard road. I feared that what he hoped to find at the end was not wisdom or peace, but paybacks. Marino was always angry about something.
"Let me ask you this, Doc," he said to me when I returned to the table. "How would you feel if they caught the assholes who killed Mark?"
His question caught me by surprise. I didn't want to think about those men.
"Isn't there a part of you that wants to see the bastards hung?" he went on. "Doesn't a part of you want to volunteer for the firing squad so you could pull the trigger yourself?"
Mark died when a bomb placed in a trash can inside London's Victoria Station exploded at the moment he happened to walk past. My shock and grief had catapulted me beyond revenge. It's an exercise in futility for me to contemplate punishing a group of terrorists, I said. Marino stared intensely at me.
That's what's known as one of your famous bullshit answers. You'd give them free autopsies if you could. And you'd want them alive and would cut real slow. I ever tell you what happened to Robin Naismith's family?
I reached for my drink.
Her father was a doctor in Northern Virginia, a real fine man, he said. About 6 months after the trial, he came down with cancer, and a couple of months after that was dead. Robin was the only child. The mother moves to Texas, gets in a car wreck, and spends her days in a wheelchair with nothing but memories. Waddell killed Robin Naismith's entire family. He poisoned every life he touched.
I thought of Waddell growing up on the farm, images from his meditation drifting through my mind. I envisioned him sitting on porch steps, biting into a tomato that tasted like the sun. I wondered what had gone through his mind the last second of his life. I wondered if he had prayed. Marino stubbed out a cigarette. He was thinking about leaving.
Do you know a Detective Trent with Henrico? I asked.
Joe Trent. Used to be with K-9 and got transferred into the detective division after he made sergeant a couple of months ago. Sort of a nervous Nelly, but he's all right.
He called me about a boy,
He cut me off. Eddie Heath? I don't know his name. A white male about 13 years old. We're working on it. Lucky's is in the city.
Lucky's?
The convenience store where he was last seen. It's off Chamberlain Avenue, north side. What did Trent want?
Marino frowned.
He gotten word that Heath ain't gonna pull through and is making an appointment with you in advance?
He wants me to look at unusual injuries, possible mutilation.
Christ, I hate it when it's kids.
Marino pushed back his chair and rubbed his temples.
Damn, every time you get rid of one toad, there's another to take his place.
After Marino left, I sat on the hearth in the living room watching coals shift in the fireplace. I was weary and felt a dull, implacable sadness that I didn't have the strength to chase away. Mark's death had left a tear in my soul. I'd come to realize, incredibly, just how much of my identity had been tied to my love for him. The last time I saw him was on the day he flew to London, and we managed a quick lunch downtown before he headed to Dulles Airport. What I remembered most clearly about our last hour together was both of us glancing at our watches as storm clouds gathered and rain began to spit against the window beside our booth. He had a nick on his jaw from where he'd cut himself while shaving, and later, when I would see his face in my mind, I would envision that small injury and for some reason be undone by it. He died in February, while the war was ending in the Persian Gulf. And determined to put the pain behind me, I had sold my house and moved to a new neighborhood. What I accomplished was to uproot myself without really going anywhere, and the familiar plants and neighbors that once had given me comfort were gone. Redecorating my new home or redesigning the yard only added to my stress. Everything I did provided distractions for which I had no time, and I could imagine Mark shaking his head. "For someone so logical," he would smile and say. "And what would you do?" I would tell him in my thoughts some nights when I couldn't sleep. "Just what the hell would you do if you were still here instead of me?" Returning to the kitchen, I rinsed out my glass and went into my study to see what awaited me on my answering machine. Several reporters had called, so had my mother and Lucy, my niece. Three other messages were hang-ups. I would have loved an unlisted number, but it was impossible. The police, Commonwealth's attorneys, and the 400 or so appointed medical examiners statewide had legitimate reasons to reach me after hours. To counter the loss of privacy, I used my answering machine to screen calls, and anyone who left threatening or obscene messages ran the risk of being tracked by caller ID. Pressing the review button on the ID box, I began scrolling through the numbers materializing on the narrow screen. When I found the three calls I was looking for, I was perplexed and unsettled. The number was curiously familiar by now. It had been appearing on my screen several times a week of late when the caller would hang up without leaving a message. Once, I had tried dialing the number back to see who answered, and had gotten the high-pitched tone of what sounded like a fax machine or a computer modem. For whatever reason, this individual or thing had called my number three times between 10:20 and 11 p.m. while I was at the morgue waiting for Waddell's body. That didn't make sense. Computerized telephone solicitations shouldn't occur so frequently and at such a late hour. And if one modem trying to dial another was getting me instead, shouldn't someone have figured out by now that his computer was dialing a wrong number? I woke up several times during the few hours left of the early morning. Every creak or shift of sound in the house made my pulse pick up. Red lights on the burglar alarm's control panel across from the bed glowed ominously. And when I turned or rearranged the covers, motion sensors I didn't arm while I was home watched me silently with flashing red eyes. My dreams were strange. At 5:30, I turned on lamps and got dressed. It was dark out, and there was very little traffic as I drove to the office.
The parking lot behind the bay was deserted and littered with dozens of small beeswax candles that brought to mind Moravian love feasts and other religious celebrations. But these candles had been used to protest. They had been used as weapons hours before. Upstairs, I fixed coffee and began going through the paperwork Fielding had left for me, curious about the contents of the envelope I'd found in Waddell's back pocket. I was expecting a poem, perhaps another meditation, or a letter from his minister. Instead, I discovered that what Waddell had considered extremely confidential and had wanted buried with him were cash register receipts. Inexplicably, 5 were for tolls, 3 others were for meals, including a fried chicken dinner ordered at a Shoney's 2 weeks earlier. Chapter 2. Detective Joe Trent would have looked quite youthful were it not for a beard and receding blonde hair that was turning gray. He was trim and tall, a crisp trench coat belted tightly around his waist, his shoes perfectly shined. He blinked nervously as we shook hands and introduced ourselves on the sidewalk in front of Henrico Doctor's emergency center. I could tell he was upset by Eddie Heath's case. "You don't mind if we talk out here a minute," he said, his breath turning white, "for privacy reasons." Shivering, I tucked my elbows close to my sides as a med-flight helicopter made a terrific noise taking off from the helipad on a grassy rise not far from where we stood. The moon was a shaving of ice melting in the slate-gray sky. Cars in the parking lots dirty from road salt and frigid winter rains. The early morning was stark and without color, the wind sharp like a slap. And I observed all this more keenly because of the nature of my business here. Had the temperature suddenly risen 40 degrees and the sun begun to blaze, I don't think I could have felt warm. "What we got here is real bad, Dr. Scarpetta," he blinked. "I think you'll agree we don't want the details getting out." "What can you tell me about this boy?" I asked. "I've talked to his family and several other people who know him. As best I can ascertain, Eddie Heath is just your average kid. Likes sports, and has a paper route, has never gotten into any trouble with the police. His father works for the phone company, and his mother sews for people out of the home. Apparently last night, Mrs. Heath needed a can of cream of mushroom soup for a casserole she was fixing for dinner, and asked Eddie to run over to the Lucky convenience store to get it." "The store is how far from their house?" I asked. "A couple of blocks, and Eddie's been there any number of times. The people working the counter know him by name." "He was last seen at what time?" "Around 5:30 p.m. He was in the store a few minutes and left." "It would have been dark out," I said. "Yes, it was." Trent stared off at the helicopter, transfigured by distance, into a white dragonfly softly thudding through clouds. "At approximately 8:30, an officer on routine patrol was checking the back of buildings along Patterson and saw the kid propped up against the dumpster." "Do you have photographs?" "No, ma'am. When the officer realized the boy was alive, his first priority was getting help. We don't have pictures. But I've got a pretty detailed description based on the officer's observations. The boy was nude, and he was propped up, with his legs straight out, and arms by his side, and head bent forward. His clothing was in a moderately neat pile on the pavement, along with a small bag containing a can of cream of mushroom soup and a Snickers bar. It was 28 degrees out. We're thinking he may have been left there anywhere from minutes to half an hour before he was found." An ambulance halted near us. Doors slammed and metal grated as attendants quickly lowered the legs of a stretcher to the ground and wheeled an old man through opening glass doors. We followed and in silence walked through a bright antiseptic corridor, busy with medical personnel and patients dazed by the misfortunes that had brought them here. As we rode the elevator up to the third floor, I wondered what trace evidence had been scrubbed away and tossed in the trash.
What about his clothes? Was a bullet recovered? I asked Trent as the elevator doors parted.
I've got his clothes in my car, and will drop them and his perk off at the lab this afternoon. The bullet's still in his brain. They haven't gone in there yet. I hope like hell they swabbed him good.
The pediatric intensive care unit was at the end of a polished hallway, panes of glass in the double wooden doors covered with friendly dinosaur paper. Inside, rainbows decorated sky-blue walls, and animal mobiles were suspended over hydraulic beds in the 8 rooms arranged in a semicircle around the nurse's station. 3 young women worked behind monitors, one of them typing on a keyboard, and another talking on the phone. A slender brunette dressed in a red corduroy jumper and turtleneck sweater identified herself as the head nurse, after Trent explained why we were here.
The attending physician's not in yet, she apologized.
We just need to look at Eddie's injuries. It won't take long, Trent said.
His family's still in there?
They stayed with him all night.
We followed her through soft artificial light, past code carts and green tanks of oxygen that would not be parked outside the rooms of little boys and girls were the world the way it ought to be. When we reached Eddie's room, the nurse went inside and shut the door most of the way.
Just for a few minutes, I overheard her say to the Heaths, while we do the exam.
What kind of specialist is it this time? The father asked in an unsteady voice.
A doctor who knows a lot about injuries. She's sort of like a police surgeon.
The nurse diplomatically refrained from saying I was a medical examiner, or worse, a coroner. After a pause, the father quietly said,
Oh, this is for evidence.
Yes. How about some coffee? Maybe something to eat?
Eddie Heath's parents emerged from the room, both of them considerably overweight, their clothes badly wrinkled from having been slept in. They had the bewildered look of innocent, simple people who have been told the world is about to end, and when they glanced at us with exhausted eyes, I wished there was something I could say that would make it not so, or at least a little better. Words of comfort died in my throat as the couple slowly walked off. Eddie Heath did not stir on top of the bed, his head wrapped in bandages, a ventilator breathing air into his lungs while fluids dripped into his veins. His complexion was milky and hairless, the thin membrane of his eyelids a faint bruised blue in the low light. I surmised the color of his hair by his strawberry blonde eyebrows. He had not yet emerged from the fragile prepubescent stage when boys are full-lipped and beautiful and sing more sweetly than their sisters. His forearms were slender, the body beneath the sheet small. Only the disproportionately large, still hands, tethered by intravenous lines, were true to his fledgling gender. He didn't look 13.
She needs to see the areas on his shoulder and leg, Trent told the nurse in a low voice.
She got 2 packets of gloves, one for her and one for me, and we put them on. The boy was naked beneath the sheet, his skin grimy in creases and fingernails dirty. Patients who are unstable can't be thoroughly bathed.
Trent tensed as the nurse removed the wet-to-dry dressings from the wounds.
Christ, he said under his breath. It looks even worse than it did last night. Jesus. He shook his head and backed up a step. If someone had told me that the boy had been attacked by a shark, I might have gone along with it, were it not for the neat edges of the wounds, which clearly had been inflicted by a sharp, linear instrument, such as a knife or razor. Sections of flesh the size of elbow patches had been excised from his right shoulder and right inner thigh. Opening my medical bag, I got out a ruler and measured the wounds without touching them, then took photographs.
See the cuts and scratches at the edges? Trent pointed. That's what I was telling you about. It's like he cut some sort of pattern on the skin and then removed the whole thing.
Did you find any anal tearing? I asked the nurse.
When I did a rectal temperature, I didn't notice any tears, and no one noticed anything unusual about his mouth or throat when he was intubated. I also checked for old fractures and bruises.
What about tattoos?
Tattoos?
She asked as if she'd never seen a tattoo.
Tattoos, birthmarks, scars, anything that someone may have removed for some reason, I said.
I have no idea, the nurse said dubiously.
I'll go ask his parents. Trent wiped sweat from his forehead. They may have gone to the cafeteria.
I'll find them, he said as he passed through the doorway.
What are his doctors saying? I asked the nurse. He's very critical and unresponsive.
She stated the obvious without emotion.
May I see where the bullet went in? I asked.
She loosened the edges of the bandage around his head and pushed the gauze up until I could see the tiny black hole, charred around the edges. The wound was through his right temple and slightly forward.
Through the frontal lobe? I asked.
Yes.
They've done an angio?
There's no circulation to the brain, due to the swelling. There's no electroencephalic activity. And when we put cold water in his ears, there was no caloric activity. It evoked no brain potentials.
She stood on the other side of the bed, gloved hands by her sides, an expression dispassionate, as she continued to relate the various tests conducted and maneuvers instigated to decrease intracranial pressure. I had paid my dues in ERs and ICUs, and knew very well that it is easier to be clinical with a patient who has never been awake. And Eddie Heath would never be awake. His cortex was gone. That which made him human, made him think and feel, was gone, and was never coming back. He had been left with vital functions, left with a brain stem. He was a breathing body with a beating heart, maintained at the moment by machines. I began looking for defense injuries. Concentrating on getting out of the way of his lines, I was unaware I was holding his hand until he startled me by squeezing mine. Such reflex movements are not uncommon in people who are cortically dead. It's the equivalent of a baby grabbing your finger, a reflex involving no thought process at all. I gently released his hand and took a deep breath, waiting for the ache in my heart to subside.
Did you find anything? The nurse asked.
It's hard to look with all these lines, I said. She replaced his dressings and pulled the sheet up to his chin. I took off my gloves and dropped them in the trash as Detective Trent returned, his eyes a little wild.
No tattoos, he said breathlessly, as if he had sprinted to the cafeteria and back. No birthmarks or scars either. Moments later, we were walking to the parking deck. The sun slipped in and out, and tiny snowflakes were blowing. I squinted as I stared into the wind at heavy traffic on Forest Avenue. A number of cars had Christmas wreaths affixed to their grills.
I think you'd better prepare for the eventuality of his death, I said.
If I'd known that, I wouldn't have bothered you to come out. Damn, it's cold.
You did exactly the right thing. In several days, his wounds would have changed.
They say all of December's going to be like this. Cold as hell and a lot of snow.
He stared down at the pavement.
You have kids?
I have a niece, I said.
I've got two boys. One of them's 13.
I got out my keys. I'm over here, I said.
Trent nodded, following me. He watched in silence as I unlocked my gray Mercedes.
His eyes took in the details of the leather interior as I got in and fastened my seatbelt. He looked the car up and down as if appraising a gorgeous woman.
"What about the missing skin?" he asked. "You ever seen anything like that?"
"It's possible we're dealing with someone predisposed to cannibalism," I said. I returned to the office and checked my mailbox, initialed a stack of lab reports, filled a mug with the liquid tar left in the bottom of the coffee pot, and spoke to no one. Rose appeared so quietly as I seated myself behind my desk that I wouldn't have noticed her immediately had she not placed a newspaper clipping on top of several others centering the blotter.
"You look tired," she said. "What time did you come in this morning? I got here and found coffee made, and you had already gone out somewhere."
"Henrico's got a tough one," I said. "A boy who probably will be coming in."
"Eddie Heath."
"Yes," I said, perplexed.
"How did you know?"
"He's in the paper, too," Rose replied, and I noticed that she had gotten new glasses that made her patrician face less haughty.
"I like your glasses," I said. "A big improvement over the Ben Franklin frames perched on the end of your nose. What did it say about him?"
"Not much. The article just said that he was found off Patterson and that he had been shot. If my son were still young, no way I'd let him have a paper route."
"Eddie Heath was not delivering papers when he was assaulted."
"Doesn't matter. I wouldn't permit it. Not these days. Let's see."
She touched a finger to the side of her nose. "Fielding's downstairs doing an autopsy, and Susan's off delivering several brains to MCV for consultation. Other than that, nothing happened while you were out, except the computer went down."
"Is it still down?"
"I think Margaret's working on it and is almost done," Rose said.
"Good. When it's up again, I need her to do a search for me. Codes to look for would be cutting, mutilation, cannibalism, bite marks. Maybe a free-format search for the words excised, skin, flesh. A variety of combinations of them. You might try dismemberment, too, but I don't think that's what we're really after."
"For what part of the state and what time period?" Rose took notes.
"All of the state for the past 5 years. I'm particularly interested in cases involving children, but let's not restrict ourselves to that. And ask her to see what the trauma registry's got. I spoke with the director at a meeting last month, and he seemed more than willing for us to share data."
"You mean you also want to check victims who have survived?"
"If we can, Rose. Let's check everything to see if we find any cases similar to Eddie Heath's."
"I'll tell Margaret now and see if she can get started," my secretary said on her way out. I began going through the articles she had clipped from a number of morning newspapers. Unsurprisingly, much was being made of Ronnie Waddell's allegedly bleeding from his eyes, nose, and mouth. The local chapter of Amnesty International was claiming that his execution was no less inhumane than any homicide. A spokesman for the ACLU stated that the electric chair may have malfunctioned, causing Waddell to suffer terribly, and went on to compare the incident to the execution in Florida, in which synthetic sponges used for the first time had resulted in the condemned man's hair catching fire. Tucking the news stories inside Waddell's file, I tried to anticipate what pugilistic rabbits his attorney, Nicholas Grumman, would pull out of his hat this time. Our confrontations, though infrequent, had become predictable. His true agenda, I was about to believe, was to impeach my professional competence and in general make me feel stupid. But what bothered me most was that Grumman gave no indication that he remembered I had once been his student at Georgetown. To his credit, I had despised my first year of law school, had made my only B, and missed out on law review. I would never forget Nicholas Grumman as long as I lived, and it didn't seem right that he should have forgotten me. I heard from him on Thursday, not long after I'd been informed that Eddie Heath was dead.
"K. Scarpetta?" Grumman's voice came over the line.
"Yes." I closed my eyes and knew from the pressure behind them that a raging front was rapidly advancing.
"Nicholas Grumman here. I've been looking over Mr. Waddell's provisional autopsy report and have a few questions."
I said nothing. I'm talking about Ronnie Joe Waddell.
What can I help you with?
Let's start with his so-called almost tubular stomach. An interesting description, by the way. I'm wondering if that's your vernacular or a bona fide medical term. Am I correct in assuming Mr. Waddell wasn't eating?
I can't say that he wasn't eating at all, but his stomach had shrunk. It was empty and clean.
Was it perhaps reported to you that he may have been on a hunger strike?
No such thing was reported to me. I glanced up at the clock and light stabbed my eyes. I was out of aspirin and had left my decongestant at home. I heard pages flip.
It says here that you found abrasions on his arms, the inner aspects of both upper arms, Grumman said.
That's correct.
And just what exactly is an inner aspect?
The inside of the arm above the antecubital fossa.
A pause. The antecubital fossa?
He said in amazement.
Well, let me see. I've got my own arm turned palm up, and I'm looking at the inside of my elbow. Or where the arm folds, actually. That would be accurate, wouldn't it? To say that the inner aspect is the side where the arm folds, and the antecubital fossa, therefore, is where the arm folds.
That would be accurate.
Well, very good. And to what do you attribute these injuries to the inner aspects of Mr. Waddell's arms?
Possibly to restraints, I said testily.
Restraints?
Yes, as in the leather restraints associated with the electric chair.
You said possibly.
Possibly restraints?
That's what I said. Meaning you can't say with certainty, Dr. Scarpetta?
There's very little in this life that one can say with certainty, Mr. Grumman.
Meaning that it would be reasonable to entertain the possibility that the restraints that caused the abrasions could have been of a different variety, such as the human variety, such as marks left by human hands?
The abrasions I found are inconsistent with injuries inflicted by human hands, I said.
And are they consistent with the injuries inflicted by the electric chair, with the restraints associated with it?
It is my opinion that they would be.
Your opinion, Dr. Scarpetta?
I haven't actually examined the electric chair, I said sharply. This was followed by a long pause, for which Nicholas Grumman had been famous in the classroom when he wanted a student's obvious inadequacy to hang in the air. I envisioned him hovering over me, hands clasped behind his back, his face expressionless as the clock ticked loudly on the wall. Once I had endured his silent scrutiny for more than 2 minutes as my eyes raced blindly over pages of the casebook opened before me. And as I sat at my solid walnut desk some 20 years later, a middle-aged chief medical examiner, with enough degrees and certificates to paper a wall, I felt my face begin to burn. I felt the old humiliation and rage. Susan walked into my office as Grumman abruptly ended the encounter with, "Good day," and hung up.
"Eddie Heath's body is here."
Her surgical gown was untied in back and clean, the expression on her face distracted.
"Can he wait until the morning?"
"No," I said. "He can't." The boy looked smaller on the cold steel table than he had seemed in the bright sheets of his hospital bed. There were no rainbows in this room. No walls or windows decorated with dinosaurs or color to cheer the heart of a child. Eddie Heath had come in naked with IV needles, catheter, and dressing still in place. They seemed sad remnants of what had held him to this world and then disconnected him from it, like string tailing a balloon blowing forlornly through empty air.
For the better part of an hour, I documented injuries and marks of therapy, while Susan took photographs and answered the phone. We had locked the doors leading into the autopsy suite, and beyond I could hear people getting off the elevator and heading home in the rapidly descending dark. Twice the buzzer sounded in the bay as funeral home attendants arrived to bring a body or take one away. The wounds to Eddie's shoulder and thigh were dry and a dark shiny red.
"God," Susan said, staring.
"God, who would do something like that? Look at all the little cuts to the edges, too. It's like somebody cut crisscrosses and then removed the whole area of skin."
"That's precisely what I think was done."
"You think someone carved some sort of pattern?"
"I think someone attempted to eradicate something, and when that didn't work, he removed the skin."
"Eradicate what?"
"Nothing that was already there," I said. "He had no tattoos, birthmarks, or scars in those areas. If something wasn't already there, then perhaps something was added and had to be removed because of the potential evidentiary value."
"Something like bite marks?"
"Yes," I said. The body was not yet fully rigorous and was still slightly warm as I began swabbing any area that a washcloth might have missed.
I checked axillas, gluteal folds, behind ears and inside them, and inside the navel. I clipped fingernails into clean white envelopes and looked for fibers and other debris in hair. Susan continued to glance at me, and I sensed her tension. Finally, she asked, "Anything special you're looking for?"
"Dried seminal fluid, for one thing," I said.
"In his axilla?"
"There. In any crease in skin, any orifice, anywhere."
"You don't usually look in all those places."
"I don't usually look for zebras."
"For what?"
"We used to have a saying in medical school, if you hear hoofbeats, look for horses. But in a case like this, I know we're looking for zebras," I said.
I began going over every inch of the body with a lens. When I got to his wrists, I slowly turned his hands this way and that, studying them for such a long time that Susan stopped what she was doing. I referred to the diagrams on my clipboard, correlating each mark of therapy with the ones I had drawn.
"Where are his charts?" I glanced around.
"Over here."
Susan fetched paperwork from a countertop.
I began flipping through charts, concentrating particularly on emergency room records, and the report filled in by the rescue squad. Nowhere did it indicate that Eddie Heath's hands had been bound. I tried to remember what Detective Trent had said to me when describing the scene where the boy's body had been found. Hadn't Trent said that Eddie's hands were by his sides?
"You find something?" Susan finally asked. "You have to look through the lens to see. There. The undersides of his wrists, and here on the left one, to the left of the wrist bone. You see the gummy residue? The traces of adhesive? It looks like smudges of grayish dirt.
Just barely. And maybe some fiber sticking to it."
Susan marveled, her shoulder pressed against mine as she stared through the lens.
"And the skin smooth," I continued to point out. "Less hair in this area than here and here. Because when the tape was removed, hairs would have been pulled out."
"Exactly. We'll take wrist hairs for exemplars. The adhesive and fibers can be matched back to the tape, if the tape is ever recovered. And if the tape that bound him is recovered, it can be matched back to the roll."
"I don't understand."
She straightened up and looked at me.
"His IV lines were held in place with adhesive tape. You sure that's not the explanation?"
"There are no needle marks on these areas of his wrists that would indicate marks of therapy," I said to her. "And you saw what was taped to him when he came in. Nothing to account for the adhesive here."
"True.
Let's take photographs, and then I'm going to collect this adhesive residue and let Trace see what they find."
"His body was outside next to a dumpster. Seems like that would be a Trace nightmare."
It depends on whether this residue on his wrists was in contact with the pavement.
I began gently scraping the residue off with a scalpel.
I don't guess they did a vacuuming out there.
No, I'm sure they wouldn't have. But I think we can still get sweepings if we ask nicely. It can't hurt to try.
I continued examining Eddie Heath's thin forearms and wrists, looking for contusions or abrasions I might have missed. But I didn't find any.
His ankles look okay, Susan said from the far end of the table. I don't see any adhesive or areas where the hair is gone. No injuries. It doesn't look like he was taped around his ankles, just his wrists.
I could recall only a few cases in which a victim's tight bindings had left no mark on skin. Clearly, the strapping tape had been in direct contact with Eddie's skin. He should have moved his hands, wriggled as his discomfort had grown and his circulation had been restricted. But he hadn't resisted. He hadn't tugged or squirmed or tried to get away. I thought of the blood drips on the shoulder of his jacket and the soot and stippling on the collar. I again checked around his mouth, looked at his tongue, and glanced over his charts. If he'd been gagged, there was no evidence of it now. No abrasions or bruises, no traces of adhesive. I imagined him propped against the dumpster, naked and in the bitter cold, his clothing piled by his side, not neatly, not sloppily, but casually from the way it had been described to me. When I tried to sense the emotion of the crime, I didn't detect anger, panic, or fear.
He shot him first, didn't he?
Susan's eyes were alert, like those of a wary stranger you pass on a desolate, dark street.
Whoever did this taped his wrists together after he shot him.
I'm thinking that.
But that's so weird, she said. You don't need to bind someone you've just shot in the head.
We don't know what this individual fantasizes about. The sinus headache had arrived and I had fallen like a city under siege. My eyes were watering. My skull was two sizes too small.
Susan pulled the thick electrical cord down from its reel and plugged in the striker saw. She snapped new blades and scalpels and checked the knives on the surgical cart. She disappeared into the X-ray room and returned with Eddie's films, which she fixed to light boxes. She scurried about frenetically and then did something she had never done before. She bumped hard against the surgical cart she had been arranging and sent two quart jars of formalin crashing to the floor. I ran to her as she jumped back, gasping, waving fumes from her face and sending broken glass skittering across the floor as her feet almost went out from under her.
Did it get your face? I grabbed her arm and hurried her toward the locker room.
I don't think so. No. Oh, God. It's on my feet and legs. I think it's on my arm, too.
You're sure it's not in your eyes or mouth?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.